Taylor, Michigan. We're glad they gave him a little time off this weekend so he could come and lead us in our song service throughout the weekend. So, Brother Ken, please come and lead us in the service.
Music has always been a very important part of the ministry at Belden, and we wanted it to be a very special part of our weekend. And as I was thinking of the most appropriate statement that we could make musically as we begin our anniversary weekend, it's by singing hymn number 43, and hymn those, "Great is thy faithfulness." God has been faithful. That's the theme of this weekend. And let's lift our voices in praise as we begin our musical portion of this weekend by singing to God and extolling his faithfulness tonight. Stand please with me as we sing number 43.
I will sing of the mercies of the Lord forever. Number 457.
I will sing of the mercies of the Lord forever. I will sing.
Jack Wicks is going to come lead us in prayer this time.
Shall we pray? Our Father, tonight, as we come before Thee, we do so with thanksgiving in our heart for that which Thou hast provided for Your children through Jesus Christ. We rejoice in our Lord and our Savior, and tonight we are gathered to celebrate this some 100 years of Thy faithfulness. We praise Thee and give Thee the honor and the glory in Jesus' name. Father, we thank Thee for these past years and for the faithfulness of Thy servants. We thank Thee, God, for their love and for a vision for lost souls. And Father, for taking time out of what I'm sure was busy lives to give to Thee and to reach out to mankind and present our Savior, Jesus Christ. God, tonight, as we gather in Thy house and around Thy word, we pray that our hearts will be blessed, that they will be challenged and encouraged, that we might maintain, Father, that vision which started some 100 years ago. And Father, as acquaintances are renewed, we pray, God, that there will just be joy in our hearts. Thank You, God, for all those who have traveled and visited. And Father, we thank Thee for the speakers that Thou hast provided, and the words that Thou hast laid upon their heart. God, may our hearts be tender. May they be receptive. And God, may we do that which Thou hast challenged us to do. To take the word of God to a lost and dying. Father, we rejoice in this great privilege. Thank You for Your love and for Your faithfulness. We commit this time to You in Jesus' name, our Lord and our Savior.
As we continue to praise the Lord tonight, the ladies are going to come at this time to sing for us. One formerly a member, the other two currently members, Becky Thurman, Judy Lusa, and Linda Rowe.
Thank you.
I'm sure we can call upon each of you this evening to stand where you are and give a testimony to God's faithfulness and His work in your heart and life through the ministry here at Belden. We've chosen a few individuals this weekend to come and give a word of testimony to what the Lord means to them, what the ministry of Belden has meant in their lives. And at this time, we're going to ask Mrs. Mamie Thompson if she'll please come and share a word of testimony with us this evening of what the Lord's done in her life while she's been ministering, serving the Lord, worshiping with us here in Belden these 100 years. Oh, excuse me.
Married in 1928, but it was 10 years later. I was a mother of a primary boy who was invited to come to Belden, like all Belmanites are taught, to go and tell, go be witnesses for them, and tell others who do not know me to come to the saving knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. My son was in the primary department. That's one reason why I have a very special feeling for the primary department. It was through him that I came to Belden. If you remember Mabel Milner, Martha Milner's Diner, who became a missionary and went to India with Bradford in the late 40s. Well, they invited my son, and he came to Sunday school very, very religiously every Sunday, never missed a Sunday. He got three of his buddies to come. It wasn't easy for him. He had to go and call on them every Sunday morning. Sometimes they weren't ready, but eventually two of his buddies were saved and their parents because of his insistence and persistence in going, and he had the patience of the saint. He's with the Lord now. But I remember thinking, well, he's such an outgoing boy, and he's doing things in such a grown-up way. I've got to know what he found out at his church. And so, after many months, I started attending Sunday school. Of course, I had little ones at that time, and it wasn't always possible to go on Sunday morning with other conditions up in the house. And one time, Martha Steiner invited me to a revival. It was at a tabernacle. I remember having sawdust floors. That's one thing I remember about that. And that's where I was saved. I went forward. I thought, well, I've got to know the Lord, because that's the only answer. These people are so kind. There were very difficult times. It was during the Depression. And so I went and I was saved. And to make a long story short, I was baptized by Dr. Fulton. And instead of sending my children to Sunday school, I attended Sunday school. And it wasn't very long then that I became interested in the missions. It was because of Ruth Ryburn. We were going to the Women's Missionary Fellowship. And she gave me a bunch of papers, and she says, I want you to make the report on Hong Kong for the missionary group. And I want you to report about the missions there. And I was scared silly. And I had a bunch of papers to study and to look over, and I knew more about Hong Kong than I thought. Well, I have to know more about Hong Kong than any of those women in that missionary group, because otherwise I can't. I'll fall flat on my face up there. So I became so interested in Hong Kong that all the missionaries that came to Belden, and there were many, and that's why it's such an outgrowing church, because we are interested in missions. We get to know them like they're our next door neighbors. We know their wants and their needs and their habits and everything. We know them. We sincerely know them and we love them, each and every one, and we pray for them. And do you know, because we know so many missionaries so all over the world, that they're praying for us, and that's why we're a growing church. That's why that we are what we are. We're witnesses for the Lord, because we want, just like Mrs. Milburn and Harry and Martha, they saw the need in that. We were living in an apartment building just 2 doors away from them. There were many children there. They got all the children to go to Sunday school. They got them to go to church. And like I say, because we went, there was 5 other people who were saved. And they were living a rugged life then. I mean, and their lives changed. And it's really what we're here for, isn't it? So anyway, well, the year, the following years, 1950s were very, you know, 1940s, we had the war. It was difficult. It was difficult for everyone. But Belden was standing tall, and there were more people being saved and coming to church. And in the 60s, things began to get very turbulent in my house. I had teenagers, and at that time, Pastor Dyer, Dr. Dyer, was the pastor at Belden, and he had a heart for the young people. He wanted to know their needs. He asked them questions. He had them ask questions of him. And he was very sincere and kind-hearted and just wanted to help them in every way, because there were problems in the public schools. That was when segregation was so such a determination. And there were things going on in the schools that parents didn't know about because of the conditions. And teenagers were hard to handle, but the Belden teenagers got along very nicely because they had a great leader. They had youth leaders. Some of the youth leaders are here tonight. Mr. and Mrs. Jim Gabriel, for one. If it wasn't for them, my children would probably be out on the street. Mr. and Mrs. Beveridge, and Roger Williams, and my mind went back. Anyway, there were so many. There was Gus Beveridge, and many of the assistant pastors and youth leaders then, with men and women, and they had the children and the teenagers really living for the Lord and witnessing and doing things that were proper. And really, it was such a blessing to me, because I had not the easiest life, because I had an unsaved husband. And there were only certain meetings I would go to church if that were important. That was Sunday school, the worship service, and the missionary meeting and prayer meeting. But anything else, it wasn't important. And in his mind, it was just a fantasy. It was a big fantasy, and sooner or later I would give it up. But I didn't. And I think that when he saw how the children were, after all, I did have 6 children, and it wasn't easy when your husband isn't saved, and he did things that were not the best. But the Lord was with me, and they weren't 5 years for me. It felt like he carried me all through the hard places. I lost a son in the epidemic of the spinal meningitis epidemic in 1944, and after that, it was pretty hard for me, because husband didn't think that God was there because he took his son. So I still say that Belden really has taught and preached and stood tall in all these 52 years that I and people around here. They're my family and my children.
The reason we can have an anniversary weekend like this, celebrating our 100th anniversary, is because of the faithfulness of people like Amy Thompson and others of you who have gone through the years serving God so faithfully. And you know, in order for Belden to have 125th or 150th, and for the other churches that some of you folks are representing tonight to have their anniversaries and years ahead, it's going to take us being faithful to our God, take us being faithful to our church ministries, in order for that to happen. And in your program, at the last page, you'll find the theme chorus. I want you just to sort of have that ready, because the song I'm going to sing at this time incorporates that theme chorus in it. And when I'm done singing this song, I'll have you join me in singing the chorus together a couple times. This is a chorus that I hope will not just be something that we do sing together this weekend, but a chorus that will ring through your minds in weeks ahead here. That you will be people who God will find faithful, that people in future generations will find faithful, and that Belden can have a future anniversary, should the Lord tarry, because of what we have been able to do in service to Him. Listen carefully as I sing this song. let's stand together as we sing this chorus. Sing it as your prayer to the Lord.
But all of you that have notified us that you're planning to attend the banquet. We have you registered, and we're looking forward to the banquet tomorrow evening, Algarve's Restaurant up on Milwaukee Avenue. And we're looking forward to the evening. Dr. Paul Tassel is our speaker for this banquet tomorrow night. Then on Sunday morning at 9:30, our Sunday school hour. Probably many of you have heard that the speaker for the Sunday morning hour was to have been Reverend Truman Robertson. We received word last week that Brother Truman Robertson had to go into emergency surgery at St. Mary's Hospital in Rhinelander, and then had to go in for a second surgery. And we haven't heard yet this weekend whether or not he may have to have his leg amputated. Blood is not flowing through the feet and so forth, and so he's in critical condition, and we ask you to remember our brother True Robertson. And we're happy that we were able to call out west, Mesa, Arizona, just after we heard of Brother True's condition, and ask our brother Roger Williams if he would come and share the pulpit ministry this weekend. Brother Roger Williams is here with us this evening and with us for the weekend, and he so gladly consented to preach the word this Sunday morning. I suppose he's going to preach the conference message Sunday morning and get a head start on it, and then he can go out there to Anaheim and, well, anyway, we're looking forward to his preaching Sunday morning. Then at 10:45, I'll be preaching. And then in the afternoon at 3 o'clock, we'll have our anniversary concert, Sunday afternoon at 3. At that time, we'll be partaking of the anniversary cake. The anniversary cake is after the fashion of the old Belden building. You'll see it after the service this evening. It's downstairs in Ketchum Hall. And we let them eat cake of Chicago, made a replica of the old Chicago Belden Church building. And with the exception of the steeple, we can't put the steeple on until Sunday. We're afraid it's going to topple if we let it stay on all weekend. But you can see the cake downstairs after the service. I need to remind you, too, that if you have children in the nursery, would you pick up your children immediately after the service is finished and take them with you down to Ketchum Hall? Because those who are in the nursery would also like to visit with folk after the service. If you'll take them with you and eat together and enjoy the fellowship right after the service here tonight. Recognitions. We're going to take a moment each evening to make some recognitions in the service. What we'd like to do right now is find the states that are represented. What state are you from?
California.
That's all? California and Illinois?
Arkansas.
Michigan.
Indiana.
Arizona. Texas. Iowa. Wonderful.
Connecticut.
New Mexico.
Arkansas.
Virginia. Isn't that wonderful? How many here from the state of confusion? I got a few there. That's wonderful. We're glad for all of you who come from all over the country to celebrate this weekend together. And you know, there were some that wanted to be here this evening. And we can't read all the letters of people that wanted to be here this evening and couldn't. Just would be impossible. We got many, many letters from people that wanted to be here. And one of my favorites, since I am still her pastor, and she's not able to be with us, is Rhoda Ladendorf. Some of you remember Sister Rhoda, who's out in California now. And she just said, I will not be able to attend the anniversary celebration, but I do hope I can have a pictorial history of the church. I'm closing the money for a banquet ticket and so forth. In other words, she says, if I can't come, I want somebody else to go in my place. And so she purchased a ticket for somebody else to go in her place. And Rhoda has been a faithful prayer warrior as well as a faithful supporter financially of this church. And we thank the Lord for her. Another one that we received a letter from, I don't believe she was ever a member of this church. She might have been. Gladys Caldwell. And Gladys is now living in Butler, Pennsylvania. And she wrote us a wonderful letter and thanking us for the invitation to be here. And I've enjoyed her fellowship here when she's been able to be with us. She's not able to travel as much as she used to, and she's living in Butler, Pennsylvania. Then we received a wonderful letter from George and Mary Gardner. And many of you know George and Mary Gardner, and they too wanted to be here, but George isn't doing too well physically, and therefore they just couldn't make the trip. And we received a wonderful letter from them, and we've enjoyed their fellowship. Then this letter, I'll read excerpts from this one. Happy birthday, dear Beldenites. Because of our work schedule, we are unable to be in attendance for this very special occasion. And then they go on and said, Gus had the privilege, remember Gus? Had the privilege of being youth director at Belden Avenue in 1951, and we were married there in August 1952. Who's this Gus? Gus Kulich. And wonderful letter. I won't be able to read all of the letter to you. And they would love to have been with us too. And so it goes. We'll read some other letters over the weekend too. And you'll notice in your bulletin for the weekend, there are greetings from many people. And there again, we got many, many other greetings. We'll read some of them over the weekend that we weren't able to include in our bulletin for this weekend. And we just thank the Lord for all who have written to let us know that they are thinking of us as we celebrate this weekend together. Now we have another testimony at this time, and I've enjoyed the fellowship of Brother Ron Duncan since coming to pastor this church. Ron's been up and he's been down, and I'm going to get back up again. And Ron's had some real hard times lately. But God's been good to him, and we're praising the Lord for what he's done. And you saw him a few months ago, he was just about flat out. We're thankful to the Lord. He saw him through his recent accident. He's able to move about. Lord bless you, Ron, as you share your testimony with us tonight.
The men that have pastored this church these many, many years have done a wonderful job. They have kept us all faithful. They have preached the truth. And I'm thankful for each and every one of them. For the influence they have had on my life, and for what I have been able to learn through them and with them. I think back of my very young years. Some of the Sunday school teachers I had, Foster Vick for one. Those of us boys in his class gave him quite a time during the Sunday. Some of the things we used to do to that man, I'm surprised that he didn't kick us all out. But he was a wonderful man of God, and it was a joy to sit in Sunday school under him. And I think of this gentleman that Pastor just mentioned, Gus Kulich, in my high school years. Made quite an impression upon me. He worked with us young fellows and the girls, too. After school, it wasn't to just run off somewhere, but we would make a turn over to the church. It was always open to us. Gus was always around and willing to do with and for us. And I appreciate that very, very much. And a couple in this church, Brother Jim Gabriel and his wife, in our teen years when they had us in Live Wires for Christ, and we praise the Lord for them and their lives and their example to us. Mr. and Mrs. Charlie Barrett, who worked diligently with us. Charlie Barrett is now with the Lord, and he's enjoying being with him, I'm sure. I think of so many others that had an influence in my life. When I was in the service, faithfully, we received bulletins from this church so that we did not forget what was going on here at home while we were somewhere else serving our country. And I thank those folks who were diligent in making sure that we got those every week. And there is so much that I would like to say, but there is so much more that has to be taken care of and done this evening. And, reflecting back to Pastor Dyer's ministry, one of the things Kathy and I were reminiscing this just a couple of weeks ago, of his faithfulness to us as a family. When our daughter Lori was in a coma in the hospital, and they didn't give us much hope for her that night. Pastor Dyer was there at our side, and I thank him for that. His caring ministry down to us as individuals. That's the kind of an individual that he was, and I thank him for that. The very next day, he himself ended up in the hospital with a heart attack. And so even in the physical state that he was in, he took the time out to deal with us as individuals, and I thank him again for that. For all of you who are here tonight, for those who I did not know prior to 1942, which is when I came to Belden, I want to thank you for your part in keeping our heritage true, and for giving us the opportunity to have a church like Belden to attend and to come to and to share with. And as all churches, we as a family have problems from time to time, but it's a joy to see how a family can work together and work through the difficulties. There's a verse of scripture found in Psalm 133, verse 1, which says, "Behold, how good and how pleasant it is for brethren to dwell together in unity." And I thank God for the opportunity of being able to attend, to serve, and to worship in a church where we can witness unity daily. Again, I thank each one of you for having a part in my life. The pastors that we've had, I thank them. And it's just a joy to be here tonight and see so many faces that I have known for many, many years. And I hope that we get a chance to spend much time this weekend in getting reacquainted. Thank you.
Shelter of my story, my
speaker this evening. Former pastor of Belden, as we've already been told, during the years 1964 through 1968. And we thank the Lord for Brother Bob Tyer, the ministry he's had in Belden in the past, the ministries he's had in other areas as he's come back to visit Belden in a different capacity. He's been serving with Baptist Children's Home, representing them, and it's been a joy to know him there. A joy to know him also through the ministry of Baptist Bible College and School of Theology. And I thank the Lord for this dear brother. Some months ago, he wrote to me when he was having a little bit of difficulty, and said that if he couldn't come, would it be all right to ask his son to take his place? And it's all right with me. His son's a great preacher, great pastor. We thank the Lord for him. I wish I had time to read a letter that I received from his son, congratulating us and telling us of what impact Belden had upon his life. That's where he met his one and only. And he tells about it in that letter. Just a very sweet letter we see from Bob Dyer, Jr. We're just delighted to have Brother Dyer with us this evening, his dear wife sitting down here at the front. And we thank the Lord for our wives. They're so, mean so much to us in the ministry. Well, our brother has about an hour or two of message, so I'm going to get him on and let him preach. He starts at 10. It's an opportunity to hear the word preached, and we're here to listen to God's word. That's what has made Belden so special, because we major on the word of God and upholding the Lord Jesus Christ and his word. We thank the Lord tonight for his faithful preachers. Our pleasure, Brother Bob, as you come and share with us.
Thank you, Pastor. What a thrill, what an enjoyment, what a delight it is to be here tonight and to hear all these wonderful things from the lips of you folks who really make up Belden. You're the folks that make up the church. We who have had the privilege of serving as pastor have always had the privilege of being here in that capacity, but you're the real Belden in every way. Pastor, I didn't ask your permission, but I'm going to read Bob's letter. Is that all right? Thank you. I'm going to do it anyway. That plate down there before we break it. As I thought upon coming, I want to interrupt myself for a moment, okay? Is Mrs. Hamilton here?
Yes.
Could we have her stand? Great. There she is. Thank you. Church, the situation as a family situation. That is, when you are involved in the Lord's direction, it's something your family prays with you about, and you go together to serve the Lord in that way. I'm sure you men who are here in the audience tonight have identified with that as pastors, as God's servants in various capacities, and it's been a joy to see how God used this church in the lives of our two that were home. Our oldest girl was married when we came here, stayed on the West Coast. She did come and visit. You were very kind to her and those weeks that she was here with her family. But the other two, Bob and Evelyn, were here and had a tremendous learning experience. And for that, my wife and I will ever be grateful to you, dear folks. And so I'm going to do all my reminiscing and all my thinking about that kind of thing in the two letters they have written, and then get right into the message. As I have thought about this, coming here for this weekend, and even sitting on the platform, I had to tell myself, you can't get started reminiscing about this and that, this person that, you'll never get through. And I don't want any Eutychuses falling out of the window tonight. We're going to just stick to it. We're going to give you some letters. This reflects
some people, not all, it does not obviously touch to touch all the lives and touch their lives in words. Bob's letter says, "Dear Pastor Sastrom, I went to the file and got a copy of this. I didn't know he'd sent it to you. So I went to the church office. The secretary gave me a copy. I want to express my sincerest and warmest congratulations to you and all at Belden on this wonderful occasion. Belden holds for me a lot of very special memories. I can remember the first time that I walked into the auditorium on Halstead Street, a sense of history and awesomeness that, being the birthplace of the regular Baptist Fellowship, seemed to fill the air. And I would say amen to that. The very same thing happened with me when we first saw the building and realized all that it meant." He goes on to say, "I enjoyed tremendously my year of serving in Awana." He came with us in between Western, the years he'd been in Western, 2.5 years, and spent a year at home, and then he went on to Baptist Bible Seminary in Johnson City, and this is where he's referring to. "I enjoyed tremendously my year of serving in Awana and teaching the junior boys Sunday school class in the annex, as well as being part of the college career group while I worked in the loop in between my sophomore and junior year of college. It was a wonderful year of getting to know Dr. Ketchum and his family, Dr. Jackson and his family, because of their being so close to our apartment on the north side. Also, I had the privilege of getting to know many of the gals that worked in the regular Baptist office who have been friends and encouragers over the years. Thank you, ladies." Again, I said it wouldn't start going down the line, so I won't. I'll stop right there, but thank you. And thank God for the memory of these two godly men, Dr. Ketchum and Dr. Jackson. I remember Bob coming home, Thanksgiving time, and so forth, from Johnson City. And Dr. Ketchum calling and saying, I have to see that boy." Well, we'd say to Bob, "Dr. Ketchum called, wants to come over." And I always thought to myself, what in the world does Doc need to see a guy in college? He isn't going to teach him anything or tell him anything. You know what they did? They both loved baseball, and they both loved the Lord, and they loved theology. And they'd go over there together. Bob would go over there, and they'd sit for hours talking and visiting and challenging. And of course, I guess Doc got him wrapped up in a few domino games as well. That was always part of the scene, too. Well, without a doubt, he goes on to say, "Probably my fondest memory of Belden will be the stairway on the side entrance where I met Lois for the first time. I was doing my apprenticeship with my father that summer, and amongst the funerals and the weddings and baptism and Sunday evening services, that was the time he did his first preaching. He got his baptism of fire preaching on Sunday nights that summer. That was the summer after I had the heart attack, and I welcomed him, and it gave him a great opportunity. His father mentioned to his people in New Jersey how patient and kind you were to put up with it." Well, he says, "Not only was I getting a very special opportunity to do those things, but," he said, "I was getting to know a very special young lady who was to become my greatest asset in the years that we've been together as missionaries and as pastor and wife. I'll never forget the lady that called and wanted to know if my dad would give her daughter's hand in marriage. And we both wondered why she didn't want to give the whole daughter." Well, that was Bob's humor. He was new in this business. And when the lady took the phone call and told me about it, I said, "Well, I wonder why she didn't want to give the whole daughter." All right, I had a lot of fun putting together the brochure that we use for visitation and the new church visitors handout. He said, "The one that we have here in Shawnee Baptist Church is patterned after that brochure." Some of you may remember that brochure. He did work hard on it. The printer got a couple of words misspelled, and I was really surprised at that because they were Lutherans. And instead of the precious blood that he had used in the text on 1 Peter, they had the previous blood. But he did a good job on his part. He said, "The one that we have here is the one I patterned that after. Most of all, I appreciate the people who were so kind to me and so thoughtful, listening to the messages where I literally wore their fingers out running from passage to passage, from the Old Testament to the New." He tells all the young men who come and work with him and serve with him and on his staff, "Get a text and stick with it. Don't run people back and forth." Yes, he did do that. "I can remember one of the college sponsors sharing with me that if they learned nothing else in the course of the summer I was there, they learned the books of the Bible and their location. I'll always remember the sweetness of Ann Redding. I did not know that Ann had gone home to be with the Lord until just a few minutes ago in the hall when I spoke with her daughter and granddaughter, Kathy. And he mentions here, of course, I'm sure he didn't know it either. I'll always remember the sweetness of Ann Redding and the special music, singing in the choir with Carolyn Printy, exasperating the groaning, the creaking groan of the, not the choir, he's talking about something else here. The creaky groan of the cover on the baptistry whenever you walk to the right side. Remember that? You always thought you were going to fall in when you came out that door out of the side room. Well, he said, I've used those months of preparation and training to prepare for the work of the ministry. And God certainly used those days and the years that he was associated with Belden. Thank you for your kindness in allowing me to be part of the work and ministry of Belden, sincerely in Christ our Redeemer. And I say thank you again. He is God's man today and being used of the Lord because you gave him that opportunity to serve and to share and the kindnesses you expressed to him. Neither one, Bob or Evelyn, knew that I was going to ask the other one for the information in a letter, and so they wrote independently, and this is Evelyn's. They will arrive in Tacoma, Washington. You know Bob, her husband, and their five children. Bob is a career military officer with the Air Force, 21 years now, and God has been using them out in Massachusetts as he's taught at the University of Massachusetts, the senior ROTC program. They have been transferred to Ford Air Force Base, Tacoma, Washington. They're in transit right now. We'll get there on the weekend. But before they left, she wrote this. Greetings to all on this special time in Belden's history. I have often looked back on the time spent in Belden and thanked the Lord for the experiences there. I can think of many people who made a difference in my life. A number of them served in the music ministries. It was a lot of fun to sing in the choir under the leadership of Carolyn Printing. One of the fondest memories is of the various holidays. I don't think a Palm Sunday goes by that I don't think of Ann Redding enthusiastically singing the Palms. Another musical group I think of is the Rhythm Band for the Vacation Bible School. I was given the opportunity of working in the beginner's department. What a place to learn new things. Gladys Hawkins was the best, and that's in capital letters, the best teacher I ever had. She was able to keep a room full of hot, wiggly kids' attention and keep them under control. Excuse me. She graciously and ably allowed all of the helpers to have a part in the teaching efforts. I've taught in several beginner's departments since then, and I've looked back on those early experiences and tried to emulate Gladys's techniques. This is what I'm saying when I say you blessed and been a great blessing to us and to our children. She has taught in a number of places around the world as they've traveled with the Air Force. Of course, one thing, I don't think of Gladys without thinking of Pat Brand. Together, they led the junior Sunday school department where I taught my first Sunday school class. To say I was green is an understatement. I was given lots of encouragement by Pat and Gladys. I've often wondered if any of those sixth grade girls learned anything. Most knew so little about God's love. Many were from homes where no one cared. It was, of course, down in the location where we formerly were. One student was always prepared and even knew more than her teacher, Karen Pine. Was always, always ready with the answers. I'm glad her parents did such a good job of helping her at home with her memory verses and the lesson. My highlights of those years spent at Belden was our wedding. Kindnesses were shown to us by so many people. I remember Lee Gabriel offering her home to house my in-laws, a detail I completely overlooked. Betty Klein did such a lovely job of coordinating the reception, in spite of the fact I didn't want to use the basement. She had to make a temporary kitchen upstairs. How many other girls had the privilege of having Mrs. Coriel make their wedding gown? Finally, there were all the people who came to wish us well and to share in our happy day. Many faces and events come to mind of other events, and the sings by the lake in the summer, taking nurses back to Swedish Covenant, baptismal services, and the most unusual baptistry I've ever seen.
Yes,
same baptistry. You walk across it, and it sounded like you were going to fall in. And she goes on to say, hearing Dr. Ketchum and Dr. Jackson preach, and then meeting missionaries from Bangladesh and so many more, I felt privileged to have been able to spend those few years at Belden. One thing stands out in my mind above so many. They were faithful. One could always count on them being in their place, serving God week after week. She's referring to all of you who were in the church at the time she was there. That was a lesson I've remembered many times. Being faithful to God is so important. We'll be praying for you as a church as you begin your second century. Well, I said I'd confine myself to that kind of reminiscing. Thank you for letting me do it. Let's go, please, to the Word of God and to the 100th Psalm. I thought and thought and thought on the subject. Had 3 years to do it because the first letter came about that time, and so I had a long time. The more I thought about it, the more complicated it became. Then in January, the Reader's Digest, National Geographic came out with a 100-year edition. I thumbed through that, and I said, ah, that's it. I got lots of sermon material there. Look at that. This. And I said, oh, they've already read that. They don't want to hear that. But so many things happened in the period of time when this church was begun. You didn't read the National Geographic. I would suggest it to you to just look at some of the history, some of the magnanimous, outstanding, dynamic things that happened in that period when this church was founded in 1888. Truly, God has been faithful. Murray Murdoch did an excellent job in the article in the bulletin in the years covering the history of the church, the things he mentions. But God's faithfulness and God's people's faithfulness has made it all possible. Well, in thinking about it, I concluded that the 100th Psalm would be a great one to share. And the more I studied, the longer I studied on it, put it away, and studied some more, and put it away, the more I found that I couldn't do just the 100th Psalm. No preacher ever finds it possible to get it down. Dr. Tassel, usually he alliterates, and he gets about 8 or 9 letters there in his outlines. So I'm up against the same thing tonight. I want to give the things that we're going to share to you in three basic ideas. One, remember. Two, rejoice. And three, rest. Now, when I get to that last one, I hope I can clear that up, because my thought is not for all of us now that we've reached the 100 point, year point in the church, to hang it up and say, well, that's enough, that's good enough, we did a good job for 100 years. But let's look at this 100th Psalm for a few moments. Make a joyful noise unto the Lord, all ye lands. Verse 1, serve the Lord with gladness. Come before his presence with singing. Know ye that the Lord, he is God. It is he that hath made us, and not we ourselves. We are his people and the sheep of his pasture. Enter into his gates with thanksgiving and into his courts with praise. Be thankful unto him and bless his name. For the Lord is good, his mercy is everlasting, and his truth endureth to all generations. Let's pray. Dear Father, we've had such a good time tonight, reading and meeting and exchanging greetings with one another, rejoicing in your goodness and mercy, lifting from our hearts hymns and songs and joyful praise, listening to special music, fine testimonies, and now we come to your word, which above all other things has been central and the most important thing in the life of this church. And we pray you'll bless it to our hearts for the glory of Christ, whose blessed, wonderful, peerless name we pray. Amen. Actually, you can't begin with a 100th Psalm. Israel was a great nation, disobedient to God, chastised by the Lord, but over and over in the Lord's mercy, when he brought them back, there was always a recounting of God's blessings, recognizing who he was. A lot of singing and rejoicing. Ken Vine mentioned this church has always had a music history, and that was always those things that were in our thinking when we left. The joys of the Lord sung and shared, as our kids have shared in their letters. Well, because they did this, I began to study this section of the Word of God, and I recognize that you had to go back to Psalm 95. Will you go back there with me, please? Oh, come, let us sing unto the Lord. Let us make a joyful noise to the rock of our salvation. Let us come before his presence with thanksgiving. Make a joyful noise unto him with psalms. For the Lord is a great God and a great King above all gods. In his hand are the deep places of the earth, and the strength of the hills is his also. And he goes on to say in verse 6, oh, come, let us worship and bow down. Let us kneel before the Lord our Maker. For he is our God, and we are the people of his pasture and the sheep of his hand. So the psalms just begin to roll and to crescendo from Psalm 95 right on up to what? To 100. Here in 96, he says again in verse 1, oh, sing unto the Lord a new song. Sing unto the Lord all the earth. Sing unto the Lord, bless his name. Show forth his salvation from day to day. And on through that chapter, he rejoices in all that God is, all that God has done for them. Then you come to the 98th Psalm. And here, oh, sing unto the Lord a new song, for he hath done marvelous things. His right hand and his holy arm hath gotten him the victory. The praise and the joy and the worship that was seen in the earlier Psalms now has with that a coupling of remember the holiness of the Lord. Dear friends, we should always, when we come to God's house, over and over, year in and year out, may it always be that we are remembering God is holy. The psalmist phrases it well for us, for he says not only is God a marvelous God, has done marvelous things, his right hand and his holy arm hath gotten him the victory. The Lord hath made known his salvation. He hath remembered his mercy and his truth toward the house of Israel. All the ends of the earth have seen the salvation of the Lord. Make a joyful noise unto the Lord. All the earth make a loud noise and rejoice and sing praise. So when I say remember, remember the holiness of God. Remember who God is. Israel did. We should, as we commemorate this century history of this church, remember that God in all his loving kindness, his holiness, his mercy, and his grace, his sovereignty, is the one whom we worship. Remember his holiness. And then you'll be able to sing, as we've been reminded of it several times. You'll be able to show forth, as Psalm 98 verse 2 says, the salvation of the Lord. He maketh known his salvation, his righteousness, hath he openly shown in the sight of the heathen. He remembered his mercy, his truth toward the house of Israel. Certainly that could be applied, though I am very clear on my theology. The church is not Israel. Israel is not the church. But when it comes to the history of this church, it is 100 years behind it. God has been merciful. His truth has been that which he has blessed us with. I appreciated what Ron said. Every man who's been pastor here has preached the truth. Thank God for those that preceded me, the opportunity I had to preach it. Brother Gordon Shipp, God bless his memory, and his effectual ministry, and for your present pastor, Brother Sashford. I thank God for such men as well as the others that preceded us. Again, verse 4 in the 98th Psalm, make a joyful noise unto the Lord, all the earth, with a loud noise, and rejoice and sing praise. Sing unto the Lord with the harp and the voice of the psalm, with the trumpets and the sound of the cornet. Make a joyful noise before the Lord the King. Verse 9, before the Lord, for he cometh to judge the earth with righteousness, he shall judge the world and the people with equity. Israel was known for its tremendous music, its history. Go with me, please, to Psalm 137. Here you find them in captivity. And this is what is written in Psalm 137, verse 1. By the rivers of Babylon, there we sat down. Yea, we wept when we remembered Zion. We hanged our harps upon the willows in the midst thereof. For there they carried us away captive and required of us a song. They that wasted us required of us mirth, saying, sing us one of the songs of Zion. Verse 4, how shall we sing the Lord's song in a strange land? You remember the punishment the Lord brought because of their disobedience? Let them go into captivity to Babylon. And of course, Babylon knew all about their great And all that made up the life and religious life and worship of Israel. And so they wanted them to lift in song and praise. Oh, it couldn't be done, is what the psalmist tells us. By the rivers of Babylon, there we sat, yea, we wept. What a joyful thing to know the Lord, rejoice in His grace and love, and to be able to have a song. Israel did not have a song. Actually, they were so tremendous in all that they did, the things that you read in 1 Chronicles, 2 Chronicles, the musicians, that they would have made the Mormon Tabernacle Choir sound like kindergarten kids. I know we can't fathom that. We can't bring that up in our thinking because we find ourselves saying, well, that's what we hear, that's what we know. Who would be greater than they are? Well, Israel's music and rejoicing, all of which worshiped the Lord, was that which excelled that group and any other such group that we could name. Well, in verse 1, make a joyful noise of the 100th Psalm, and then goes on to say, serve the Lord with gladness. That's the thing that I remember, and I'm sure you, as you contemplate, remember and think on these things tonight, the history of this church and its ministry, that it was a time in all times of not only making a joyful noise, but serving the Lord with gladness, coming before His presence with singing. And then in verse 3, there is the truth of what every believer needs to know, both those in the time when this psalm was written and all of us. Know ye that the Lord, that is Jehovah, the Almighty, He is God. He made us, and not we ourselves. We need to often be reminded of that. I think of the fellow who said, folks, I'd like to sing a solo for you. I'd like to sing How Great I Am. Well, we got a lot of those kind around. I bump into a few in my travels once in a while. But those who really recognize the greatness of God are those who serve the Lord with gladness, come before His presence with singing, because they know that it is the Lord that made us, not we ourselves. We are His people, the sheep of His pasture. How kind, how gracious. You know the 23rd Psalm, where it tells us very clearly and blessedly that the Lord is our shepherd, David said. We can say that as His child. I shall not want. Now the way the heart keeps rejoicing and not wanting and not getting caught up in materialism and the things all about us of the world is to keep a happy heart, a singing heart. And so we're reminded we're the sheep of His pasture. We are to enter into His gates with thanksgiving and His courts with praise, be thankful unto Him and bless His name. Those are the memories that I have of Belden, even though it was a shorter period of time pastored here than the other men. It was stated earlier, a heart attack got in there and changed things. We needed to make a move. I had been involved with the Urban Renewal Program for some time, and I knew the heavy weight that was involved with that. And I tried before the Lord to find the right answer, and I believed it to be to resign, go to a smaller pasture, which I did in Indiana. You know, those days were hard days, dark days. And finally, after 8.5 years with that heart problem, we had to have surgery. And I found over in the book of Psalms, Psalm 57:7, oh God, my heart is fixed, my heart is fixed. I will sing and rejoice. Well, that was a good verse, and I kept rejoicing in it. And 12.5 years went by, and last October we had to have it done all over again. So I had to look for a new verse, and I found Psalm 108, verse 1. Oh God, my heart is fixed, 2 times. I will sing and rejoice. So that's been the one. But I remember this church in its great peons of praise and rejoicing before the Lord, being thankful unto Him and blessing His name. For the Lord is good, verse 5 says, His mercy is everlasting, His truth endureth to all generations. And thinking of the history of this church, certainly that has been true, not only to Israel, but to us. God's mercy has been from everlasting to everlasting. Theme of the conference these days, a century of God's faithfulness in the midst of change. Lamentations 3:23b, great is thy faithfulness. What does it mean to rest? It means that with that history behind us of remembering, of rejoicing, and having the blessings of God all these years in our life, in church, homes, that now we can go on in the next century and on with our lives, whatever year that is for us, and rejoice in that we can rest in the fact that God has not only done all that in the past, He's the same God. He's going to keep on doing it. He's going to keep on making blessings come and His mercy known. Unbelievers coming to know the Savior, being a new creature in Christ. And those of us who are walking with Him, going along in years, we find His mercies are new every morning, His faithfulness. We're so thankful to God for that. Now, it takes a little planning, a little thinking on these things. And out of it, God will use and bless all who will do this in a particular way. I'm a little sad when I'm in some of our churches and family life Bible conferences that pastor's discouraged. Nothing seems to be happening. And when I visit with him for a little while, I find that he hasn't done much planning, much strategizing, not laying long-range five-year plans. Thank God that was true here, and you people and Pastor Ship laid out these plans and made the move from the old location out here. And I'm sure with Pastor Sastrom there are many plans. Otherwise, you wouldn't have the number of missionaries you have. Thank God for that part. As Mamie Thompson said, that's made this church great. Go into all the world and preach the gospel. Thank God it's still your theme. Well, what about planting? I heard a little story about two old ladies in a rest home. And the office admitted a person to their rest home. It was a gentleman, an elderly gentleman. And of course, I'm sure you are aware that your old ladies always look over the new gentleman. Just in normal practice, so they did. These two dear ladies sitting out there in the hall saw him. They said, isn't he nice looking? I think I'll get acquainted with him, one of them said. The other one said, well, you go ahead. I'm a little bashful. I'll wait till later. She went up, introduced herself, started talking, telling him a little bit about the place and about herself. And then she said, my, you look just like my third husband. Oh, he said, is that right? How many husbands have you had? Just two. That's planning. That's thinking. We can rest in the blessing of God if we'll stay busy for the Lord, make some plans, and if that dear old lady can get onto the light, get on with the happenings in the rest home, certainly we can as well. God bless you, Pastor, people, dear friends who have come tonight. Thank God for all that He's done, for His glory. Let us pray. Father, we rejoice in what we have been hearing tonight. We remember with thankfulness to Thee, as Israel did, that You're the holy God. You're the great God, wherein we can rejoice in Your holiness and righteousness, and loving kindness and mercy, long-suffering. Then, our Father, we can rest in who Thou art, not rest from labor, for Your word reminds us to go ye into all the world. Come unto Me, all ye that are weary and heavy laden, and I will give you rest, rest in salvation. Rest in the walk of the believer, but then a going ministry for the Savior. Thank You, this church has had such, and those are the kind of people that's been part of it and are part of it today. Bless and lead, glorify Yourself, bless our lives. In the name of the Savior we pray, for His praise and for our good in Christ's name. Amen.
Number 503 in your hymnals. First verse talks about Jesus, I am resting in the joy of what Thou art. And that fourth verse, as Pastor Dyer reminded us, is resting in the Lord while we serve Him. Never lift Thy face upon Me as Thy word, and wait for Thee. We'll sing the first and fourth verses of the same 503. Stand please with me as we sing.
that time and join with us this evening and sleep in a little later in the morning if need be. And be back with us tomorrow night if you have your reservation in for the banquet tomorrow night in Allgauer's restaurant in Northbrook. Looking forward to that. Paul Tass will be speaking tomorrow night, some more special music, testimonies. Wonderful time. And all day Sunday. Wonderful weekend together. What a birthday celebration. We're glad you're here to be a part of it. Let's return thanks for the food and fellowship we'll share downstairs. What a joy it is, our God, to be here this night and join together in testimony to thy faithfulness. Thou hast been good. We thank thee for the manifestation of thy grace through the years in salvation and in strengthening the brethren. Carry on. We thank thee, our God, for what thou hast done in countless thousands of lives. What a joy to be a part of this century. We thank you, Father, for these who have come back to fellowship with us this weekend. We pray that we will be a blessing to them, Father, and encouragement. No doubt many have come too with discouragement, with disappointment. Many have come to have a little recharging of their batteries. And we pray that we might be of encouragement to one another this weekend. But especially that we might be encouraged in our God. Thank you, our God, for your presence here this night. Ministering to our hearts through these testimonies in song and spoken word. Thank you, Father, for those who have helped to prepare, provide the refreshments that we are about to partake. Ask your blessing upon them. Grant a good time of fellowship together, returning mercies as we travel after the service. Bring us back tomorrow, banquet again for Sunday services. And then for those countless numbers that wanted to be here tonight, we remember them. Especially, Father, tonight, we want to remember Brother Drew Robertson. We look forward to hearing him preach the word. Lord, thou hast the reason for all things. Minister to him in a very special way tonight there at the hospital. Thank you, Lord, for your favor in his life. Thank you, Father, for the fellowship we'll share now the rest of this night and this weekend. May he be the glory.